church.
Good morning, Jim.
Both Jim and Gary are away this morning. And so you've got me all the way through. Last week, I had told several people that I had a wedding last weekend. And I told some people that my son was getting married. But I don't guess I told hardly anybody that I was performing the wedding of my son last Saturday afternoon.
Oh, wow. Oh.
And so it was in Gainesville, and we just decided to go to the dinner and party, and we just enjoyed the festivities. I got a reminder on my phone the next morning, you can still make it to church. And I thought, let's roll over and just stay a little longer. So, we knew y'all were in good hands, and so we didn't come. In every pew, I know this because I went through every pew this morning, there is a black registration pad that was sitting to the inside aisle on these rows, and it's actually on your seat, not on the chair back in front of you. I left them on the seat. And hopefully they started on the seat. And set them up and down the row in which you're seated. Sometimes in the overflow, people get helpful and pass them back a row. If they do that, make a note. I have practiced this morning some of the names that I know I should know, that I've struggled with. I used, I rewatched the broadcast. The camera turns during the hymns. And so the back rows are hard to identify. But I was able to study up some this morning. Got more names right today than I have in quite a while, but still have holes. So if you would sign in, it is a big help. It is an aid to me. And so I appreciate y'all doing that this morning. I've got your pad. I'll bring it in a little bit. But anyway, I'll go ahead and let you know that Jim and Robin are on a cruise. They weren't sure that they were going to get away because of Robin's dad's failing health. We'll mention it again in a moment during prayer, but Ron Adams, Robin's father, passed away on Thursday. And so, at present, it's planned to be a private family service. But as we know more, we'll try to keep you all appraised of what's going on. Our hymn of praise this morning is Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee. It's number 89.
If you can, now please stand and sing with me.
Oh,
In our time of prayer this morning, we certainly need to remember Robin Dawson in our prayers. As I mentioned, Robin's father passed away on Thursday. We also need to remember Bob Stefanov. He's hospitalized and in kidney failure. So please keep him in your prayers. He's over in the Melbourne area. Cecil Funkhauser goes to the hospital tomorrow to have a lung biopsy. And Linda Austin Funkhauser had a heart cath and everything came out okay. So those are what I know of in hospitalizations and whatnot. Let's go to the Lord in a few moments of silent prayer, then I'll lead us in prayer and we'll end with the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. Gracious God, we come before you, each with our own story, each with our own needs, each with our own cares and concerns. Lord, hear our prayers. Thank you for your great love. That loves us right where we are. Not where we wish we were, not where we ought to be, not even where we may have been. But right here, right now, Lord, you love us. Lord, if there's something in our lives that we need to clean up this morning, Lord, let us take those steps. Lord, help us to be the people you called us to be. Lord, continue to guide us on our way, that when we finish this journey, we may hear, "Well done, good and faithful servant." Lord, in all these things, we remember how Jesus was asked by his disciples, "Lord, teach us to pray." And Jesus' answer, "When you pray, pray like this. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory." if you need a Bible reference for that, it's Psalm 119. I had to look it up. I couldn't remember. At this time, I'd invite the ushers to come forward as we prepare to give unto the Lord of God's tithes and of our offerings. Chapter 11, I was prepared to begin at the 39th verse, but I'm going to start at the first and then go to the 39th. First and second. Now faith is being sure of what we hope for, certain of what we do not see. This is what the ancients were commended for. These were all commended for their faith, yet none of them received what had been promised. God had planned something better for us, so that only together with us would they be made perfect. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinful men, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. May God add a blessing to the reading and hearing of God's holy word. Last week, Jim preached on the first verses of chapter 11, And I thought, well, this would be a good follow-up. I'll preach on the first verses of chapter 12. And then I got looking and thought, well, I don't want to start with therefore. We've all been through, some of you are visiting today, and I apologize. I should apologize to everybody who's not visiting because they've heard this too many times. But whenever a chapter starts with therefore, always look and see what it's there for. Maybe I should apologize to those who are visiting anyway, but it's a lot of chapters in our scripture begin with therefore, and you always need to back up and look and see what the context of that is, because it's therefore is based on something that precedes it. And late in the week, after I'd already turned in my verses to Robin, I got to looking and thought, well, I really ought to start with 11:1, where Jim started last week, because it ties together with verse 39. Verse 2 in particular, but I don't want to re-preach what Jim has already preached. But listen to verse 2 again. This is what the ancients were commended for. Verse 39. These were all commended for their faith. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. That's an old translation, but that's the one that's up here. These were all commended for their faith, yet none of them received what they had been promised. Their hope was in a Savior who had not yet come. God had planned something better for us, so that only together with us would they be made perfect. It's because Paul and the others of his generation recognized Jesus as the Christ, that those who had come before were made perfect in their faith, that God would see them through, that God would be faithful. And God has been faithful. The 11th chapter is filled with examples of faith. People who put their faith in Christ, put their faith in God, and in a Christ who had not yet come. And together with them, they are made perfect. We are all in this together. It's not them and us. It's all of us in this together. And they are the great cloud of witnesses. Not just the ones who are named in chapter 11. They are little snapshot examples of people of faith in the Old Testament. But they are not the only examples of faith in the Old Testament. Nor are the people who are identified in the Old Testament. There are lots of faithful people in every generation who are to us anonymous. They're simply unnamed. But they were faithful. For all of us, we have family and forebears who have been faithful across the ages, some of whom we know by name, many of whom we do not. As most of you know, I've done a lot of work on my genealogy and can go back quite a ways in different lines. And there are examples of faithful Christians sprinkled back not just sprinkled, layered and layered and layered and layered in my family, going way, way, way back. But there are lots of other faithful people whose names I don't know. Cousins and aunts and uncles and others in those same families and their families and their families. We are a part of a tremendous journey. And those who have gone before us are part of that cloud of witnesses. So he says they were commended for their faith, but it's come to completion or made perfect in us. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, it's not just the people of the Old Testament. The Apostle Paul is in that cloud of witnesses. Peter, James, John, you name off the disciples. You can go around the room if you've ever tried to look at all our windows, and the disciples are all represented. They are a part of the cloud of witnesses. Mary and Joseph. Too many to begin to name. And because we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. And let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Long before knee surgery, I was a runner. It's not surprising to me that in our 50th reunion of the cross-country team from Winter Park High School, who won the state championship, most of us have had knee surgery of one sort or another. A couple of the guys haven't, but they're due. We ran in cross country on golf courses and out in pathways pretty much without an audience. Our parents sometimes, a few people, you know, scattered along the course would cheer. But in track season, we ran in stadiums, nearly empty stadiums. You could hear people calling your name because there were such a smattering of people. It wasn't like a roar of a giant crowd like we'll be witnessing the Super Bowl today. I don't know how those guys hear anything in the midst of just the noise and the volume that is there. But we were able to pick out people cheering for us when we would run around the track. Of course, only when we passed the home stadium. There was nobody in the visitor stadium, the visitor side. And there weren't a lot of people on the other side, but you'd hear family and friends and teammates cheering for you as you went around the course. That is such a strong imagery for me, to think that we're in this journey of life, that we're surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, and they are cheering for us. They're calling out your name and my name. Can you hear them calling?
They're wanting us to stay the course. They're wanting us to keep on keeping on.
Our track team never got the tearaway sweats that they have now. You can go out and right at the finish line, you can just peel them away. They have little snaps, you know, or Velcro or something. I'm not exactly sure, but they just tear away. And you can step up to the line if it's cold out or whatever. Ours were always the ones you had to get in and out of. When we did wear sweats, which wasn't real often. But Paul encourages us to get rid of those extra encumbrances. It never occurred to us to run a race in our sweats. We always peeled them off before we ran. We ran in just the lightest shorts, the lightest shoes, the lightest shirts we could wear. We didn't want to be encumbered by anything that would slow us down. Listen to Paul's encouragement. Let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. I can just picture trying to run in those bulky sweats that we had and how entangled we might have gotten if we had done so. The imagery of the sin. I was fascinated as a child with magnets. And magnets can go either of two ways. When you get two magnets next to each other, they can either be drawn toward each other or they can repel. And the sin that clings so closely. I picture when we take things out of the dryer and how, you know, things are stuck together sometimes. And if you let them get near each other again, they'll just, almost like magnets, they'll try to cling back. That's what sin does. We shake it off. We resolve to never do this, that, or the other again. And it clings so closely. Faith is essential. But in our journey, we've got to continue to get rid of the things that encumber us, the things that hold us back. And then let us run with endurance or perseverance the race that is set before us. This version says perseverance. Another version says endurance. They're trying to get at the issue of keeping on, keeping on. No matter what we face, no matter how high the obstacles, no matter how hard it seems today, we've got to keep on, keeping on. Run the race with perseverance. Run the race with endurance. Keep running the race. As long as we draw breath. The race is marked out for us. God is always going before us. Martin Luther said, faith alone, grace alone, Bible alone. John Wesley, the founder of Methodism, talked about prevenient grace, the grace of God that goes before us, the grace of God that enables us to say yes, the grace that allows us to stay faithful in the journey. It's not that our life is laid out and we have no choice. We have choices all along the way. In the only race in which I ran JV in high school, I had sprained my ankle and was demoted to the JV team. And I was leading the race for the first time, the only time, in high school that I led the race. One of my teammates was a state champion, so it isn't always bad to be in second or worse. But the only race that I got to lead, I missed a turn and had to double back and get back on the course. We have choices. We can stay the course, remain faithful, or we can go awry. Stay the course. And this is where it's important to remember, we are not alone. The image on the front of your bulletin is one of a solo runner. We often think of track when you think of individuals running a race. But in the same way that we are surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses, we are a part of a gigantic marathon. Boston has nothing on the Christian race. All of us are in it. All of us are going at different speeds. But all of us are in the race together. And not just us. Those watching. The Episcopalians across the street behind me. The Lutherans up the road, the Presbyterians across the street the other way, the Baptists, the Baptists, the Baptists, the Baptists. We're all in it together. And we should be encouraging one another in the same way that we are being encouraged by those who are surrounding us, who have gone before us. We need to be encouraging one another. If you see somebody's shoe untied, tell them. We're on the same team. Encourage one another. Remember that we're all in this together. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus. When we were running, we were always told to watch the shoulder blades of the person in front of you and watch for them to falter so that you could slip on by them in a race. We're not running against one another. We're not trying to get there first. We're not trying to elbow somebody else out of the way. All of us are trying to get to the same place. And we are called to fix our eyes on Jesus. To fix your eyes. Some of Joy's relations use the term keep your eyes skint. It's a good expression. Keep your eyes fixed on Jesus, who is the author and finisher of our faith. This version says perfecter. Who, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross. How many years did Jesus know the cross was the end of the road? Since he was 12? Since he was 4? Since he was 30? Early in his ministry, Jesus begins to talk about the cross being the end of the line. He knew the cross was coming. It hung in the background of everything he did, everything he said. He knew the cross was coming, but he endured the cross. He endured it for the years leading up to the time he was hung upon it. He hung for hours. From 9 in the morning to 3 in the afternoon. Pushing up for breath. Falling back on the nails. And in the midst of those hard to take breaths, he said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." He endured the cross for us. What can we endure for him? Can we keep on keeping on when our breath is hard to take? When death closes in, will we be faithful to him who is the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him, Jesus knew the end was not the cross. He endured the cross. He endured the suffering. But it was for the joy that was set before him, the joy of being in God's presence once again. The joy of being in our cloud of witnesses. Jesus is cheering us on. And sat that scorning the shame and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such suffering, such opposition from sinful men, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. We're called by the grace of God to stay the course to the very, very, very end. And to give God the glory. Can you hear them calling your name? Keep listening for their call. Keep your eyes fixed on Jesus. Shake off all the stuff that hinders us from following him. Let us pray. Lord, thank you for your great love. Forgive us, dear God, that we have not always been as faithful as you have us to be. We've not always been as faithful as we know we need to be. Forgive us, I pray. Lord, help us to strip away the sin that clings so closely and let us run with endurance and perseverance the race set before us. In Jesus' name I pray. Our closing hymn is Blessed Assurance, number 369. Let's stand as we're able and sing together. the reason that I work so hard on names is because when I went to college, I went to a Methodist church that had hundreds of students. And when I went through the door, I was just another student that nobody knew who I was. And I ended up not staying in that church, went to a smaller Methodist church where the pastor knew my name. And it's always been important for me to know the names of my people. And so I'm going to stumble and mess up, but I'm going to keep on keeping on until we know one another, even as we are known. So that's my commitment. Now may the love of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless, preserve, and keep us all, now and forevermore. Amen.